Okay, so good morning everybody. As already mentioned, my name is Mikko Tille and I'm from UPM. And UPM is a quite huge bio company and I will explain that to you later on. But first of all, Ilkka mentioned to me that I should tell something about myself, something about UPM, something about UPM Plywood, and then explain a little bit UPM Grada, which is a special product for us, and a kind of new product or new approach to plywood, and then tell something about product development and launching. And I just recognize that you might know some things more than I do about product development, especially launching and marketing, because you have had these lectures already 2 days or 3 days. How many? 3 days. But about my career. So I'm a chemist from the University of Jyväskylä. I started studying at 1997 or something like that. And after 3 years, I stepped on the to be as a researcher in the university. I started in the industrial project where we actually do some research around DRI agents, like drag reduction agents. It means that it's a huge polymer, and when you add that polymer inside of oil pipeline, let's say in Siberia, it reduces the drag about 80%. It means that if you reduce the drag about 80%, you need less pumping power, or you are able to increase the capacity of the pipeline. And that molecule do it so that it reduces the turbulence inside of the pipe. So the main idea is that if you like to double the pumping capacity, you can add those small molecules, or you need to build up a new line. So that was my first process. It was really, really exciting and nice process. Unfortunately, we did that to Fortum, and after that project, Fortum sold that business to USA, and I need to invite something else. So we end up to found a company called Nanolab Systems, and we start to develop different kind of equipment to create nanoparticles and nanoparticle systems. So we end up to do a nanoparticle synthesizer for nanodrugs. So that we build up a system that we would be able to build up multi-layer nanostructures. Okay, and then we also did some studies or some development around carbon nanotubes and how to modify carbon nanotubes. How well you know what is the carbon nanotube? Any idea? Some of you know already. So it's the strongest material in the world. So we didn't actually make those tubes by ourselves, but we modified those tubes so that we took those tubes. These are carbon nanotubes, you can see. So, and we connect these together with covalent bonds. You know chemistry that much, that covalent bond is the bond between those two atoms and molecules. And these bonds are actually the strongest bonds in those chemicals. So we use the strongest molecules in the world, we connect those together with the strongest bonds possible. Nice story. And we made it so that we use that technology inside of resigns for composite industry, and the end product looked like that black liquid resin up there. Oh, I'm not able to use this. Oh, like this. And we sell that to windmill industry, the sporting goods and robotic arms and applications like that. Okay. I will tell you later on what happens. Then after that, I jump out of that company because of mainly my personal reasons, and founded another company. And this one was focused on the fire safety systems for plastic, composite and wood industry. And we did, for example, paper that you are not able to burn at all. As you can see, it's a glow from the middle. And these papers, these sold out as a paper sheet. We also did some carbon fiber composites and resized to those. And as you can see, you just can burn it and it glows like a red when you are burning. It's non-combustible, it doesn't burn at all. And of course, we did something with the wood as well. And today we are talking about product launch. For example, in case of this product, guess what we had when we launched that product? Any ideas?
So what do you mean, what we had?
What we had in that company when we launched that product?
Money?
To the first customer.
Research results.
Less.
Oh.
Idea. Yes. Idea. And what else? The name. You can mean hype tonight. So it was the night before the first meeting with the first customer. We need to find a name to the product. And when we go to the meeting, we have an idea and the name. And then we just start listening. We will come back to that later. Yep, okay, then we did something else as well. How many of you have been skiing in Finland or in your home country? Some of you. So you know that you have to wax your skis to be able to ski, okay? So, in this company we invited so-called nano grip, so that you are able to be faxed the ski in the factory, and the customer, end user, skier don't have to fax it at all. So what is the special thing? There's a grip and glide in the same base. So it's grip when it's stagnant, and it glides when it's on board. Really nice project, but a bit sad story at all, but still. Okay, and after all this, I step on the UPM, and now I have to tell you something about the UPM and UPM line. Any questions? Nope. So, UPM is an old paper company.
Too risky to just have an idea and name and sell it.
Sorry, what is that?
At the beginning you mentioned those fiber tubes,
yeah,
carbon tubes, and when you have just idea and the name, wasn't it too risky to do it and sell it without any product?
We will come back to that later on, but still I'm able to answer to you that when you are running out of money in small company, there is no big risks. There is only opportunity. Really. That is the real case. When you are running out of the money, and you are a small company, there is no risks. What you can lose? But let's come back later on. Okay, but today, UPM is divided in 6 different business units. UPM, biorefining, energy, Raflovac, Paper Asia, Paper ENA, and plywood, which I'm coming from. Biorefining is mainly pulp business, and there's also some timber sales under that. Then we have the biggest bioenergy company in Europe at the moment. Raflovac is making labels, special labels and just standard labels. Paper Asia and Paper ENA is making paper. And plywood is the plywood side of our company. And at the moment, we are the leading plywood supplier in Europe. And we have been producing plywood over 100 years in our US cradle. And someone has said that we are still using the same machinery. We have, of course, changed a little bit. And we are selling our products under two brand names, Visa, which is quite well known in plywood side, and then UPM Prada, which is this new thermoformal plywood material. We have a couple of applications, and the total capacity of our production is about 1 million cubic meters of plywood. It means 1 billion liters, for example. And our revenue is about 450 million euros per year. And all products are certified, or you are able to get it as certified product. And we are not the cheapest producer, but we are aiming to the most demanding high volume applications, like concrete forming business. So we are, let's say, producing as a premium bulk. So it's a high volume, but high quality and a little bit higher price. That's our market. And we have nothing to do with this black ninja in here, but we have been helping these guys to build up that Shanghai Tower. So you are able to see these concrete forming panels in here. These are our plywood. And the most demanding buildings in the world is made by using our panels, just because of quality and delivery accuracy. And the other demanding application, where we are the market leaders, are LNG tankers. It means that the liquid natural gas from Siberia is shipped, for example, to US by this kind of tankers. Inside of these kind of tankers, you have huge containers. And these containers are insulated by insulated boxes made out of plywood. Why need to be insulated? Guess what is the temperature of liquid natural gas in normal pressure?
-200.
Almost, -163 or something like that. So inside of this container, inside of this ship, the temperature is -160, let's say it so. -160. And outside, it could be +40. And what will happen if the temperature increases to +40 inside of the tanker?
Explosion.
Exactly. So it must be insulated by some kind of insulation material, insulation boxes. Why plywood? Strongest, cheapest, or maybe not the strongest, but the cost performance ratio is the best. So it's cheap enough, strong enough, but one of the most important things is coefficient of thermal expansion. If the temperature outside of the hull is, let's say, +20, and inside -160, the temperature difference is almost 200 degrees. How it shrinks? If it shrinks too much, it will open gaps to that container, and the oil gas will release. Not good idea. So they are using Invar metal. I don't know how to pronounce it, but Invar. I-N-V-A-R metal inside of those containers. The thermal coefficient expansion of this metal is almost the same than with plywood. So there is no movement between. So there's no that much movement between those two layers. That's the main reason. And inside of one of these kind of tankers, there could be 300,000 cubic meters of plywood in those boxes. 3,000 cubic meters. I guess that it's more than the building you are living at the moment. Okay, any questions? Nope. Then we will step on Grada side. And I don't know how many of you know UPM Grada already. not so many, one crate. So the Grada is a thermoformable wood panel. It's not plywood, or at least we are not willing to say that it's plywood. Why? If we are saying that UPM Grada is plywood, so what will happen when we launch the product? Our customers will compare the price level to plywood. And then when Grada is more expensive, customers start to thinking that Grada is too expensive for it, or is that it is expensive for it. But when we are saying that it's thermoformable wood material, okay, it's bio-based, okay, that's good, and they compare it to other materials, like for example solid surface, which is acrylic plastic, and the price level is more or less the same, or we are a bit cheaper. So from customer side, it's better for us that we call it as a thermoformable wood material. Do you get it? Because we are discussing about product development and launching. Why we launch it as a thermoformable wood material. Okay, the process is quite simple. So that's the idea of Grada. You take the panel, you lay up some surfaces on top of it, you heat it up to 95 degrees Celsius, and then that temperature glue lines between these layers melts, and you are able to form it. Quite simple. Then you form it, let it cool down to 70 degrees Celsius, and you are able to take it out of the mold. No need for glue, no need to any chemicals, just heat it up and bend it. Quite easy. And why? So, the reason is that all steps in the production process can be automated. If you are starting from the loose veneers, which are really thin wood layers, really fragile, resinous glue, which is quite messy, you are not able to automate the process. You can try it a couple of times. Not possible. So, I have a video for you. Hopefully this runs. This is also in the YouTube, so you are able to check this from that service as well. Let's just watch the first 20 seconds. Then you get the idea what is here. So traditionally, these are the veneers, loose veneers, and customers need to handle those, maybe sand those edges or surfaces, glue mix, use resinous glue, quite messy. Try to get those loose veneers inside of the mold. And in every step, you have to use labor force. So how to make that more easier, how to make it shorter? You just take the panel, heat it up in a flat press, like that. This will take a couple of minutes, or 1 minute. Then you hold forward, and it cools down some 10 seconds, maybe 1 minute. Get it? Great. So, this is one way how you are able to use it. So there's a robot on one end loading the panels on the rolling table, then you have through feed press feeding up those components, then you have other robot in that side feeding those four pressing steps. Oh, of course, if you have small production, you want. Like these guys from Sweden, really nice guys, even though they are Swedish. You are able to heat it in some simple press and foam press, for example, with the vacuum. So two sides, volume production or just special production, but
it's so easy to use it that our customers will love it.
And then you are able to use this kind of panels, for example, chairs, more chairs, wall panels like this, different kind of wall panels. For example, this Tongu and Cruise, you are able to machine to the flat panel before you start forming. So guess what is the difference if you like to make these machines after forming?
Much more steps.
You need CNC.
No, with CNC, really slow. But if you are able to do this to the flat panel, you can be as efficient as with the solid. Quite nice. Or you are able to print on top of it. These are the skateboards. So you are that in a huge flat panel, you are able to print whatever you like. And you cut it off and press it as a skateboard. Or you are just do something really, really different. And you are, of course, able to use Grada inside of the cars as well. And we made one kind of prototype to showcase how to use it inside of cars. And here's a flooring and front desk panel, door panels, whatever. Everything made out of wood. Quite nice. We showcased this in the Geneva Motor Show a couple of years ago. And one guy stepped in. This smells like IKEA. Ah, shit. That wasn't the purpose of the car, but sometimes things happen. So, what is the main idea? What is the main why of UBM Grada? Efficiency made easy. That's all. I like to show this to you like this because when you are launching something, you have to have a core message. Message that you believe so that your customer can believe in that as well. You really have to be behind the core message. Whatever we do with UBM Grada, efficiency is made easy. Automation, panel handling, whatever. Efficiency is made easy. So, when you start developing something, product development, this is so-called golden circle. Have you ever seen this kind of presentation? I will not go to the details, but typically, we know quite well what we are doing. Those companies like UBM, UBM Plywood, we know quite well that we are producing plywood. That's quite simple. And when you start development project, you typically know what you need to do, or what you are doing, or what your company is doing, or whatever you are aiming to do. Then the second part is how that can be done. How you do what you do. But the most important thing is why. Why you are developing what you are developing. For example, if Ilkka is your manager, he's coming to you and saying that we need to develop a red car. Okay? You may know how to do that. You will go to the paint shop, buy the red paint, and then you know what to do, you need to make a red car. But if Ilkka is not explaining why, you are not able to, let's say, give your own feedback, or your own opinion, or your own ideas, how to solve the customer problem, or how we can do what customer needs. Quite simple example, is it so? And it's really important as well from the company point of view. There is always strategy and values. There is production and some processes. This is a simple expression. And strategy and values are always connected to why. Why our company is doing what it is doing. And if you start to develop something, it's not inside of the strategy. Don't do it. Especially in UBM. If you are a small company, like a couple of examples
we have to do what we have to do if we are running out of money, and it's a totally different story. But still, then the strategy of the company is totally different. We have to do something to survive in that case. And then why we have to do it, everybody knows in a small company. But for example, in UBM, if someone is asking to me that we need to develop new kind of plywood, okay? What kind of properties? Just develop new kind of plywood, we need to do new kind of plywood. Why? We are the market leader. Why we need to develop new kind of plywood? You need to know always why. You really need to know always why. And if you are in a company like UPM, you have some machineries you have to use in production. If you are developing something that cannot be done with the current machinery, typically it's no-go. So when you start the development project, you have to clear out how you are able to produce those products or services. Quite simple way of thinking. And of course, what? It's the easy part. And then I guess that someone else has already explained to you different kind of techniques, how to, let's say, do product development or lean development and agile development and things like that. I will not go into details. But my message to you is that there's always a different kind of project development project, product development project or service development project. So you are not able to use one good advice to everything. There is no medicine to all diseases. But here you are able to see that you have maybe been involved in a project that sounds really long. This is not product development. We have been doing that in UPM as well, let's say 5 or 6 years ago. This is research. It's not development. It's research. It need to be done, but not inside of the company. Typically, those projects today are really short. And there's a lot of gates that you have to survive and read through. In UPM, it's even that bad that those guys has weekly meetings, weekly face-to-face, weekly team meetings and blah, blah, blah. It's maybe even too much, but every week we are checking where we are going and are we fulfilling why. Okay? And then when you are doing development, this is my own idea, maybe not UBM's idea. If you are not failing, you are not developing anything. If you are not failing, it's not development, then it's marketing. Then you just change the name of the product. When you develop, you have to fail. Fail fast, fail often, fail cheap. Especially if you fail cheap, be sure that you are not failing at the end of the project. But meanwhile, fail fast, fail often, fail cheap. That's the only way to get the best results. And in case of UBM Grana, UBM Grana 2000, we have had UBM Grana 1000. Which has a forming temperature 130 degrees of Celsius. Heating time about 4 minutes. And with that traditional way of doing, the heating time was something like 5 minutes. So there's a efficiency step. But this is not enough. We need to find something else and we decide that this must be 95 degrees Celsius. So that the heating time is about 1.5 minutes. Time is money. I mentioned that our message is efficiency made easy. Whatever we do, whatever we develop, we have to stand behind that message. Efficiency made easy. So, if you compare these numbers, you can reduce 65% of your production time. So, the capacity of your production can be increased more than double. Quite nice. But, how we did it? We did it in two steps. In 6 months, I was telling to my team that we started actually January. But after summer holidays in Finland, we will launch MVP, meaning minimum viable product. And then we have another 6 months to correct this minimum viable product. And we failed. We failed often, but we failed cheap. And after 6 months, well, actually those guys were ready already after four months, but we launched the MVP after summer holiday. Minimum viable product. That product having only the necessary features needed to fulfill customer needs. Okay. So, typically, when we have some kind of product development going on, we start from idea, then you have some evaluation step, maybe some patenting or other idea issues. Product, you do some product development, then commercialization and sales. This is quite normal way of we are doing things in UPM as well. With Grada, we changed it a little bit. And this is we start from the frustration or unhappiness of the customer. So we didn't have an idea how to solve the problem we had. Then we check out all those potential markets we are able to deal, where we are able to detect the same kind of frustration or some same kind of unhappiness. Then we create an idea, and then we set up strategic price. When you hear the word strategy, it always means that it's something expensive. At least for me. Have you ever heard about the strategical investments? For example, Stora Enso, when they bought those paper mills from US just to close them down after 2 years. After that failure, so they were explaining that it was a strategical investment. Yeah. Losing a huge amount of money for nothing. But in this case, the strategic means that you are finding the correct price you are able to live and you are able to serve just those customers need. I will come back to that later on. And that MVP, minimum viable product, is related to strategic price as well. And then after that, you do the product development and some sales. Okay? Get an idea. What is the difference between these? Okay. If you look at that way how we actually think about around product, for example. If you have a frustration or unhappiness, then you have this is actually related or is the value for customer. If you don't have any frustration, just leave it on. Then markets, why this is so important. Markets always means money. It means that if you are the only one having that kind of frustration, you are not able to make any money with that. So you need that frustration, then you need enough population to have the same kind of frustration. Then you are able to create money. Gate one, gate two. What about global? Is it only to that market, or are you able to multiply? Because if you are, the easiest way to make money is just to multiply the idea or the product to a different market.
copy. Then, when you have an idea to that solution, that frustration, then you actually filling up the value. And this solution or idea is never perfect. You are not able to fill up the whole value, but you have to fill up enough. And then you have to set up this strategic price. It's related to profitability and sales as well. If you are not thinking about this, I really know I have been doing this. You will end up to super multifunctional device in all colors. This customer is asking, am I able to get this at this feature? Yeah, of course. Can I get it in this and this color? Yes, you can. But what will happen? Your profitability will decrease every time when you say yes. Every time when you add something, you will decrease your profitability. Why? Quite simple. Okay, here's the price your customer is willing to pay. He has this much money. Then you will start to add those features. And at some point, you will be in the level that you are not able to make money anymore. But this customer will not say, okay, I will pay this much. No, that will not happen. Don't screw yourself. This will not happen. When you are launching your product, of course you have to put the price high enough or even a little bit more high. But you need to know what is the strategic price in that case. Especially when you are launching, but it's really important when you are developing things as well. Okay, and this is kind of the definition for minimum viable product. But please put that minimum viable product inside the Google, and then you are able to read more about that. But because this is the definition, but people understand MVP by different ways. I have my own way how I understand and how I use MVP. And there's other guys who do it by other way. But the idea is that you are just selling or launching the product or feature having only the most critical features. These others may not even exist or they are just underdeveloped. But by that way you are able to test that hypothesis that the feature you are developing is the right one. And these guys are willing to pay the price. You got it? Okay? And this is really important. I typically forget to mention about this. When you are using MVP, it's always the risk. Why? Look at this. One thing. Here you have patenting. If you are using MVP, so you will, let's say, give out some of your ideas that might be able to patent. If you haven't patented those already, it's a risk for you that you are not able to patent those afterwards. Then there's a legal issue as well. And then there's a brand issues if the quality is not right. If you have selected the customers who you are actually giving this MVP. If your customer base is like this, typically you give the MVP to some special group. Someone you know, someone maybe which are not even the most important to you. Because then if you fail, you can live with that. So, but there's always a risk when you launch MVP. You get it? Great. Then a couple of words about strategic pricing.
It's relating on what must be included and what cannot be included. It's the same story. If this part is too expensive for you, you are not able to do that. Or do that so that you have to cut it off. But if this thing is something that which is really important to the customer, then you select that one, but you are not able to take this one. Why? Because otherwise your own price will go too high. You have to decide what must be included and what cannot be included. So this is more or less related to the user experience, and this is about your own profitability. Of course, if, as we have 100-year background in UBM making plywood, we might know what cannot be included or what must be included if we know the market and customers. But what about in the situation that you really don't know the market? You have just founded your new company, producing something really new, new technology. No one else is doing that. So how to end up to the strategic pricing? This is simple. You just guess it. Just put the price and live with that. Because execution, actions is everything in business. If you just wait and you think too much about the pricing, for example, that's the stupid way of doing it. Because you set up the price, you go to the customer, you ask, are you willing to buy this one? If not, why? If the pricing is too high, okay, why it's too high, you discuss, then you really reduce the price if you can. If you can't, then you add something. It costs you less, and it gives more to the customer. Simple. But this is a really important part when you are talking about launching any product or service. And these two things are related to MVP. So, perfection is something which is totally that you don't have anything to add anymore. It's something that you are not able to take anything out. If you are thinking about the profitability, typically, when you add something, it's not more perfect than before, you just add some costs. For example, let's discuss about this one. First, from that point of view. This is a, let's say, boring example for you, I know. Everybody is using iPad. But what they leave out, what is not needed? Keyboard. No costs. Just the pad. But then we discuss about the frustration. What was the main frustration behind my iPad, the success of iPad? At least my point of view. Because I have now 4 pads in my home, and there's only one reason to that. The frustration was Microsoft. When I was starting this presentation, we wait, as you. And we wait a long time. Because this my Microsoft system did not start up. And mega trend behind iPad is internet or mobile internet. And when you like to use internet, you are not able to wait 10 minutes to get some information out of the internet. The main frustration was Microsoft, really. And how slowly it was starting up. And how they solve it, that's the different story. But the why is there. Okay. Then something about launching. I have mentioned already most of these things. But so what do you need when you are launching something? Any idea? I have been mentioned many things now. What do you need? What is the first thing? What we had when we launched that hype tonight? Sorry, hype tonight. Okay, you need the name. Is it so? What else?
Idea.
Idea. Yeah, but it's, I guess it's number three. Anything else?
Need.
What?
A need, customer need.
Yes, you need customers. That's number three, I guess. What else? Price. You need price. Don't launch if you don't have price. Really? When you go to the customer, they are asking what is the price of this. Then you have to tell them. Lie them. Tell the truth. But whatever, you have to tell the price. If you go, this is a kind of Finnish way of doing business, that you go to the customer and then he's asking that, okay, I'm interested about the buy, what is the price? I don't know yet, but maybe after 6 months we know what is the price of this product. You can't do any sale, by the way, any sales. But if you have price, put the price high enough. Yeah, at that point, you don't have to have a product. At that point, like we had. You have to have price, you have to have customer. Really? Then you have to figure out the product or service. And this is also quite important, especially if you are dealing inside of UPM, for example. You have to have a kind of idea of sales channel as well. The price is not enough if you are not able to sell it. Okay? And the last, this is the UPM part. We need to check that it's legal. This is maybe a bit funny, but still you have to check that it's legal. Whatever you are doing. And then all this, you have to have vision or plan, or vision and plan, how to reach more than 60% market share. 16% market share. Is anyone figuring out why 16? Why not 10 or 50? Why not the whole world? 100%. Why 16%? It's about innovation adoption curve. In the market, you have always different kind of customers, or different kind of customer segments. These guys in here, these are early adopters. They are willing to test, they are willing to take it in, even if it's not ready. They are looking for price premium in their own market by using some new technology, new innovation. Totally about 60% of all of your customers or the market. Then you have late adopters, these two segments. You don't have to care about these too much if you are able to reach these ones. Why? This segment, they will buy your technology or innovation if these guys are buying. If you are not able to get this 16% market share, these guys will not start using your innovation. Will not, really. It was the same case with iPhone. It start really slowly until it reached about 16-15%. Then it was boom. I was using Nokia phone. Actually, I'm still using Nokia phone. But many others of you was using different kind of phones. Before. That's why you need that 16%.
I actually don't believe it.
Really?
Because this is the share of the total people using your product. But you're talking about the share of the total population you're targeting with your product. I think these are two completely different things. I think 16% still might be nice, but I don't think that
This is the market and customers you are looking for.
I'm not convinced, but
that's good. That's really good. Because of course you are always have to rethink, and if you don't believe, you might maybe found your own company as well, and someday do things by your own way, and then you will learn what will happen. But let's say, in normal cases, it goes by this way. These guys in these two segments will not start buying your technology or innovation before this 16% is doing so. It's like an avalanche or snowball. If you get the size of your market share to 16%, it will start to generate the business by itself. It's also about the costs. When you are launching something, you put a lot of money to the marketing and sales. A lot of money to the marketing and sales compared to the sales level. Because the sales level is really small, marketing budget is much higher. If you are able to reach the 16%, then you are able to decrease the marketing budget and the sales cost. At the same time, the sales will increase by its own. And then you are able to be profitable. That's why that 16% is so important. You saw me this one.
Yeah.
If 16% of, let's say, Finnish wood companies will not start using these technologies, no goal. It will be disaster. So rethink. I'm not saying that it's impossible, but it must be, you have to have vision and plan how that can be done. If not, okay, we fail fast, we fail often, we fail cheap. Next one. Okay. And then you had some marketing communication lectures yesterday or the day before.
Yes.
Yeah, okay. This is so important that when you are doing something in development or launching, you are using whys and how and what. If your marketing or production people don't know why you are doing what you are doing and how you try to do it, it will not happen. Typically, in UPM, for example, there's a product development people. They develop something because they think that it's important. Even inside of product development, people don't know why. Maybe some guys know. When they start launching that product, they will left the case to the marketing or marketing communication. If they really don't know why they are doing and why they are launching that product, it will fail. And then we have, for example, production. If these guys here don't know why we have made this change, it will not be successful. They might not know what they are doing, but they don't know why. Motivation, skills, ideas. There's no any of those if they don't know why. That's why I would like to show you this. This can be marketing or whatever, different processes, supply chain processes, whatever. But the marketing, communication inside of your company, it's as important than communication to your customer. Especially in companies size of UPM. In that small company I sold to you, only a couple of guys and without money, of course everybody knew that why we are doing this. Okay? And before you launch anything, think about risks. And as I mentioned that in case we launched Hype tonight, we really didn't have any risks at that specific moment. No money, nothing to lose. Risks is always related to losing something. If you are not able to lose anything, there's no risk. That's my point of view. Of course, if you are creating something, and that specific moment when you get the first sales, then you have something to lose. But before, you don't have anything, you have nothing to lose. Yep. And this is a simple example. When you are launching something, for me, these rubrics are different things than for you, because we have different background. For me, these simple block games are different for me than for you. So if you are launching something that you know that you are able to fix it after launching those couple of things which are under development, or maybe not, you think that those are not so important, but if they will be important, you are able to fix those, then it's blocking. If you are launching something which has a features that you really are not able to handle, and you have no idea how to handle them, then don't launch. For example, in case of UBM Grava 2000, I showed up 6 months and 6 months at MVP between those. At that MVP point, I knew that whatever will be needed in those couple of features, we know that wasn't perfect. We are able to fix those in 6 months. So for us, it was a block game. But for you, that launching could be good. You get the idea. And it's not only the Rubik's or block game of product development. It's a Rubik's and block game of business. Okay? And if you have some issues, some blocks are not in place, communicate with the people around you, or with those people who are handling those issues when they rise up. And they will follow. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Mikko, very much for your good presentations.
You're welcome.
I think we've heard quite a lot of good information about the launching and so on.
Just on ideas.
Yeah.
Just on ideas. As I mentioned, every product development or service development projects are different. Do it by your way. That's my message.
So now we have some time for discussion. So if you have any questions, I would like to open discussion anyway. Any all the comments or ideas? Now we have experts here, so.
just to say it's correct.
But you have a brand?
Yeah.
That's
quite many. But yeah, any questions? At least one, please.
Can you please finish the story of those carbon tubes?
that company bankrupt. That's the end of the story.
So it was not launched?
It was launched, yeah. But it wasn't a successful story in business.
I have a fun question. How important is carbon footprint nowadays when you are planning to launch it?
No, well, I mentioned about that legal issue, okay. And also those issues related on the regulations in, for example, in Europe. Those are those things that you have to take care of before you launch it. Mm-hmm. So if we are launching in Europe, new product, of course we must be sure, especially in UBM, that everything is legal. Everything's inside of those regulations.
Yeah.
But to be honest, if I still have a small company, if I thinking about the way of small companies thinking, those are those things that can be solved. You don't have to take care of everything before you are launched. The carbon footprint issue is not the one your customer is willing to pay for. It's not the most critical feature in most of the cases. Maybe in some cases that's true, but 99% of cases carbon footprint is not the critical feature you have to solve right now.
But I think it's a very important anyway of UPM's brand.
Yeah, from our point of view, when we are discussing about the UPM and how we do things, it's the key of our value. Yeah, it's always included.
Yes.
We are not able to leave it out and we are not willing to leave it out. That's not an option.
Mm-hmm. When you go from minimum viable product to final product, do you change the price? Or should the final product have the same price as the minimum viable product?
Typically, it's not the same price.
Yeah. But of course, you are testing the pricing. I guess that everybody is doing so that they put the overprice when they are launching something. We do the same. Typically, the first price is too high. Just to be sure that you are able to explain to your boss that why price, that you don't have to explain to your boss why the price is that low. Yeah, that's one reason. But of course, we like to make money. We like to get the price premium, especially in those cases you are the only one in the market, or the first one in the market. The customers are doing the same. So they are willing to pay more at the beginning. So in the next product development project, after the first one, it might be that you need to reduce your costs to keep up the profitability.
Because I was thinking since you're adding features, you would be increasing the price, but that's not the case.
No.
Mm-hmm. But you have to think what you have to leave out.
Mm-hmm.
For example, in the European credit case, we are using only 1.5 millimeter thick venues. We could use whatever, from 0.4 to 3 millimeter. Different kind of layer thicknesses. We are using only 1.5. And the only reason is the strategic price. We are not able to add that wide portfolio because it's so costly. Every time when you variate something, every time when you add one feature, you will add costs.
So getting to the final product is not about adding features that the customers need. It's about simplifying, it's about making the process more efficient. Because I seem to remember that your minimum viable product, or maybe I misunderstood, was the one where you had to go up to 130 Celsius, right? Or
No. That was the product before we started.
So the minimum viable product, you were already at the 95 degrees?
Yes.
Okay, I see.
That was the key feature.
I see, I understand.
That was the only thing that we put inside of the minimum viable product.
Okay, I see.
Really good question.
Okay, thank you.
And all other things, we didn't care. Then we fixed those in 6 months. But if our customers would say that, okay, this is not what we want, then we failed, we start all over again. But luckily, it was the key, and it has been really big success for us.
And are those customers interested in this MVP if they know that in some period of time there will be something better?
If I got that correctly, the MVP can be the same product. What we
you actually are launching.
Yeah.
So,
but if you develop it and you said that you can already launch it and it's, let's say, unfinished,
yeah.
Do they buy it if they know that it will be much better in, let's say, another 6 months, that you will upgrade it?
Yeah. Are you using iPhone?
Yes, but old one.
Which number?
3.
3, okay. Have you had iPhone before that?
No, actually.
Okay, you are not a good example, but if people are using iPhone 5.
Yeah.
And when they bought the iPhone 3, they knew that the next one will come.
Yeah, but...
Yeah, the next one will come.
But it's completely new device. It's not the, actually, you know, same product.
No, yeah, but it's the next development step. And when you are selling that MVP, there's those key features your customers is looking for. And if they are willing to pay for that, they are willing to pay for that. And then you have to add the next feature if and only if the customer are asking for that or they have a frustration with that feature. If they don't have any frustration, don't do anything. And of course, in mobile phones, you have to launch a new product in every year or something like that.
Okay.
That's actually one.
You may have heard.
I got brought in here. Typically, you know those car manufacturers making these passenger cars. This is a car, real. And typically, when they launch new model or upgrade, they do it so that there's a year 2014, 15, and 16 models. I'm driving Volvo V70 2010. And I know that 2010, it has this and these features. Okay, then Tesla, the new guy, the market, how they do it? When they upgrade the product, when the, let's say the next model or is coming out?
A week ago?
Oh.
A week ago.
Yeah, but when the next one will come?
Good question.
Or to upgrade that Model 3. If this is Model 3, and they launch it a week ago, when the next upgrade to this Model 3 will come?
Nobody knows it now?
Exactly. They don't know it, even they themselves. It may come after 4 weeks, 4 months, couple of years. And it's not year. The update will come when it comes. They change, let's say, the driving wheel, if they like. Yeah, from this point, we have a new wheel, having this and these features. And that's it. Or at some morning, when you start your Tesla, there's a new program or software inside the car. That's happened. The new way of thinking, new way of product launching as well. Well, it's not only that, like Volvo 2014, and the next one will come 2015, and then when 2016 model is out, then we have added this and these features. No. Today, we don't have to wait. If Volvo customers like me, I like to get the new kind of navigation system. Why to wait 1 year if they know that they are able to add it in this one? That's the way how they do it. In UPM, we launched Flywood at 1,900. And we are still making the same. So we are a bit slow. But do you get the idea? What kind of change is happening in that industry? And I guess that it will be the same in other industries as well. There will not be any exact dates or exact years
for one model. Because the cycle time of the business is shortening all the time. That's why product development, launching of new features, is faster and faster. There's MVPs, they will take risks. For example, the software companies like Facebook, they have been adding those stupid things in the Facebook. Then when people start to complain, enough people are starting to complain. I guess that more than 16% is starting to complain. Then they pull it back. Okay, this was a mistake. Okay. Okay.
Okay. Okay, next. Our next speaker comes from Kemppi Oy and marketing director Päivi Talonen will tell us about Kemppi company and marketing launching all kinds of these things.
Oh, whatever.
And well, welcome and
thank you.
Stage is yours.
Thank you. Yes, I come from a company called Kemppi. It's right here, 10 minutes from here. And although working as a marketing director and has been doing that in industrial companies for 30 years already, I do have a technical background. I'm an engineer by education, but done marketing and sales work for all my life. So industrial marketing especially, and is very close to my heart. And I'm going to reveal a little bit to you my own feelings and my own thoughts on marketing and communication, as I've seen that you have already been touching this point already yesterday. So, how I see it in the industrial context, and also the customer focus that is so much on the table today by everybody, that you really need to know your customer and the customer journey and understand the touch points and so on. So I'm not really going through any launch project. I heard that you had a marvelous presentation by UPM on a certain launch project, but I'm maybe more concentrating on what you need to do beforehand to be able to make a great launch process. So what does it actually take? But let's put it this way, that let's start with who we are. In a nutshell. So all these videos and stuff can be found from YouTube, from our YouTube channel, also from the freshly new 1 week old Kemppi.com. You can find all this information, all the videos and stuff, and a lot of information, not only on welding, but also on industry safety and issues that people are speaking within the welding industries nowadays. So I created a topic. Mika doesn't even know my topic here. So this is what I thought I would be speaking to you about a little bit. And please feel free to interrupt me anytime you have a question or you disagree with me. Also, that is very accepted here. What do you see here? You see here a typical situation that very many business-to-business sales guys have met throughout the years. This is an advertisement that was placed in Business Week in 1958. A salesman wants to go to sell whatever they have, the new product that was recently launched. He wants to go to you because he wants you to buy it. But what does the old guy say? I don't know who you are. I don't know your company. I don't know your company's product. I don't know what your company stands for, and so on and so on and so on. So what was it that you wanted to tell me? And even today, many sales guys agree that this has happened to them, and this happens to them even today. And today's digital world is making things even harder. Also, making them better. Because at least this is how I work. If I wanted to go to a company to meet John Smith, what would I first do? I Google John Smith. I take a look who he is and what he represents. And I'm pretty sure he does the same for me. Because if I wanted to go and meet him, he would like to know that who is this bloody blonde that wants to come here and catch my brain to work for. But believe or not, this specific advertisement is still used. It is used constantly. And do you know what is the thing that has changed? Just a wild guess. What has changed in this advertisement in 60-some years? Anybody? What has changed?
Everything is online now.
Well, even if it would be online, the advertisement, there is one little thing that has changed.
Maybe he's using dye today.
Well, and he doesn't look like this. So that's the only thing that has changed, is that the guy looks a little bit more modern today, but the message is the same, the text is the same. So that's a good thing for all of us to remember, that the launch event, the successful selling of any product or service, that starts long before you meet the guy. Even long before you want to meet the guy. Another thing that we, as you said back there, it's online. Being online, being digital, as we in Gempi Company have been digital for a long, long time, as you learned that already decades ago we created the first digital welding equipment. But everyone and everything can be connected today. Internet of Things, you've heard of. Every single machine can be connected, can speak with another machine through the cloud and so on. Every single person can be connected and are connected. And in marketing and communication, these are challenges for us, but also enablers. If we know how to make the digitalization and the connectivity to work for us. At least we try to do it now. And I know many other companies try to do it also, but it's not an easy task, especially for us who have the technical background, because we are usually not that innovative, maybe. But yes, everything can be connected and everyone is connected. And that drives us, drives the things that we are doing, bearing this in mind. It looks like I'm having another video here. So what does connectivity, what can it mean?
The race in the business is on. Around the world, industrial projects are getting larger and larger. Taller office buildings, larger stadiums, longer pipelines, bigger oil tankers are constantly being built. At the same time, quality standards are becoming more and more demanding and timetables tighter. How can the owner or investor of a large project be sure that all those thousands of welds in the whole massive project meet the requirements? There's a long chain between a weld and the owner. Let's say you own a football stadium. Sounds a dream come true, doesn't it? But imagine the responsibilities you'd have. Would you be able to sleep at night knowing there are thousands and thousands of welds holding the construction together? And it is the same situation in every business field and industry. Whether we're talking about paper mills, ships, or offshore rigs, structure parts are welded all around the world by several contractors, dozens of subcontractors, and hundreds of welders. Isn't it impossible to make sure that every weld will hold up? Isn't it impossible to know what's inside every weld? Not at all. Actually, it's quite easy. All you need to do is demand that whenever welding is required, Total Welding Management Solution is used. For the first time in history, you can get all the necessary data of the whole welding process, all monitored, all documented, all controlled with one single total solution.
So it's data that works for us. Data not only in the actual welding process, but also data that we can collect from individuals. How individuals behave, how do you guys behave when you search through internet in different places. So it's data that makes us be better as companies, makes us serve you guys better. When we know what you do, is it in your information shares or is it in your welding process as here of production? When we know what you need and what you didn't do and what are the obstacles that you are fighting with, then we can better serve you. So connectivity means an awful lot to companies like ourselves to be able to really give any solutions to whichever need or challenge you might have. Coming to industrial marketing. Industrial marketing is and communication and purchasing is part of business-to-business world. But industrial products are very different from, for instance, travel, banking, insurance, and those things that are also belonging to the B2B world. So when we talk about industrial products, are they raw materials? Are they machine tools, or are they production lines or machines or whatever components? How to market and purchase those is really different from the general B2B things. And when we think about how should we communicate and what kind of channels we will be using for communicating, I think it's different. For different, even in this field, it's different for different kinds of products. It's different for different kinds of countries, genders, ages, and so on. So there are many, many different influencers that make us think and must make us think, if I want to sell and market this product or bring it to the audiences that I want to purchase this, there are many, many different things I need to take into account beforehand. And I'm pretty sure that UPM has also done their homework with all these many successful launches that they have had during the past years. But understanding what's there behind makes things, let's say, people value what we have been doing much more when people understand that we need to do a hell of a lot of homework before we can actually do the activities that the general audience sees. But what has happened in marketing? It used to be 4P, everybody in academia and in companies were talking about product, price, place and promotion. as it is, created by the famous Professor Kotler a long time ago, then people started to talk about in the 90s about communicating. It's no more just that we tell that we have this kind of product and the its price is this, and you can go to the closest supermarket to buy it, and then I make these advertisements to the magazines, and that's my promotion. That's how it was to begin with. Then people started to take the people into thinking. So maybe it's that I speak to you, and maybe also you speak to me. So that's called communicating. So it's no more about the product, it's what the customer needs. So I need to know what my customer needs, and then I need to make products to fit the customer need. We engineers are so crazy that we just go around with nuts and bolts and create nice little things, and we don't even think about that who would need them. But the research and development process fascinates us so much that there are millions of products that have never sold anything. Because as the engineers have had this fascinating feeling that I'm doing something great. But luckily, the 90s brought to our minds the fact that actually, if you don't need this product, you won't buy it, right? So we need to know the customer need. We need to have the product or the offering needs to have a cost that satisfies your need. It's not the absolute price tag, but what is the cost that you're willing to pay to achieve a solution to your need? Then you have to, it has to be convenient to buy. You don't need to go to the supermarket if you want to buy it online. So it has to be made convenient for you. And different, the convenience to different people is different. Again, said, we need to communicate, not just tell you that this is a great product when I say so. This decade is again a new era of marketing and communication. It's no more even the customer need, it's the experience. We want to have good experiences, experiences in use. We want to experience something new, and we want to achieve something new through new experiences, right? It's about exchange, exchanging money to value. If the thing that I'm going to pay money for doesn't give me enough value, I don't want to do this exchange. I don't want to exchange this money to the product that you're offering me. And I need to be able to purchase it everywhere and fast. And is it luckily or unluckily? This applies also to industrial goods. I need to have points of purchase in many different places to start the buying process. And that's a challenge also. And they talk about not communicating anymore, they talk about evangelism. A very religious word. But what happened in the ancient times? What did people do when they wanted to share information? They went to marketplaces, they went to churches, they went to parks and places like that to discuss with each other, and there was somebody standing in the Hyde Park corner telling the world of the new nice things and so on. But nowadays, the evangelism and the fact that we speak out loud of the things, it's no more in parks or marketplaces, it's in the web. So we have this whole new evangelism going on, and we are all evangelists because we all participate the discussions. We have the possibility to do so. And from the company's point of view, this is really dangerous because we really don't know what you guys are talking about us. So another challenge that we need to take into account when we are presenting our offering, new or old, to the audiences. So there is this evangelism going on, and there is nothing we can do to it. We just need to accept it and be also a participant in multiple ways. So many of the industrial companies are little by little changing from B world to C world, but it's the consumer goods that are doing their share here. But it's long way still for the industrial companies to be brave enough to start doing the E world. So we are stuck in the C world now, but some good ones are already moving onwards. We talk about integrated marketing communication nowadays. Integration means that we do connect different kinds of people, different kinds of channels, different kinds of messages. We integrate pictures, texts, sounds in multiple different forms. We ask ourselves questions. What is your need? What is the channel you want the information from? What is the content that is interesting to you? What are the influencers that make you handle information? What is the information arena you want your information from? So we need to be able to integrate the world to work for us in different channels also. And we also need to know you. So it's no more mass media. It's more and more targeted media directly to you. If you are a person who is interested in cars, just normal cars, if you get constantly marketing messages talking about buses and airplanes, they don't touch you because you're only interested in cars. So it's all this digitalization and integration and the new world and social media, blah, 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 that makes us all very picky on the marketing messages that we want to accept. So us as sellers, even more, we need to focus on knowing who you are, what is your need, what is the channel, what is the content, and then, pop, there we go. So targeted marketing, especially when we talk about new product launches. Why should I, if you are the motorcycle guy, why would I send you a huge information on the newest airplane? It might be a little different thing to buy a motorcycle than an airplane. Or if you would be a person that always wants nuclear power, they've always been using nuclear power and they are looking for nuclear power. So why on earth would I try to sell my water power plant to you? Because you are the user of nuclear power. I'm not changing the world there. Or same goes that if you are the builder of wooden houses, why would I try to sell to you concrete wall technology if your business is in making wooden houses? So there's very many different kinds of scenarios that you can think about that why, like here I showed the video with the connectivity and quality and so on. So we know that in offshore industry, for instance, today, quality issues are really, really heavily spoken out loud today, because no Shell, no Exxon, no whatever oil company there is, wants to see the fact that one of the welds will break and the whole offshore rig falls and all that oil is pumping out from the ground and it's not really environment friendly, is it? And it's not good for the reputation either. So we need to know that every single oil company is heavily interested in how can we secure quality, how can we minimize risks. So that is the kind of influence that we want to give to them. And only to them. Some other companies are not interested in that. So it's really important to know that what you are doing and for who. Who am I launching this new product to? And integrated marketing communication needs to connect the buyer and seller long before they actually meet for the first time. As said, there's always text, sound and picture, and they are composed into very many different kinds of products, articles, videos, brochures, advertisements, so on. And then this information is delivered around in very many different kinds of forums. They are face-to-face forums, there are normal internet sites, there are different places in social media, and then there is this really nice thing that also delivers information around word of mouth. And like we say today, it's evil, because the word of mouth today is all in the internet. People talk about things. And this is the funny world that every single company, industrial or consumer good company, need to play around with. The text, sound and picture is the only entity that we have. Then it's a huge world there that is delivering our information around. If we don't have strategies, if we don't know the customers, customer relationship management, if we don't have a brand, it explodes. We don't know how we can really take care of this whole world. So, been talking about challenges already a lot. So it was from P world to C world to E world. We need to know the customer journey. We need to know where his or her need arises or a challenge arises. What does he do then? When a company wants to invest into a new production line or a new, taking from my world, they need a new welding equipment or fleet of welding equipment. Why do they need it? I have to know why they need it. Is it a replacement to existing one? Have they been getting some new metals to be welded? Are they building a new factory somewhere? Are they changing from the existing supplier to a new? Are they not satisfied with the existing one? So I need to know why they need something new. And then I need to know what they do. How do they find out the information? How do they find out the solution? Who in the company is the one, the young boy or girl usually, who has been given a task? Could you please search into this and this thing? Maybe a thesis worker or summer boy or something like that. Hey, we are thinking about getting a new arc welding equipment. Could you please check from the internet, because you are so good in it. So could you please check from the internet what kind of arc welding equipment there are, new ones, and who are the providers of those. So this is happening more and more in industries and in companies, that it's not the people who actually make the buying decision, who make the buying decision, but it's actually usually the local level people who are giving suggestions. They say, okay, I have found this and this solution that really serves for us, and only this and this and this company are able to serve or sell anything to this solution. So what is left for the actual decision makers is just to discuss that which one of these suppliers can give this to me in the best possible cost. So it's an interesting thing to know that actually the 50 to 70% of decision making has taken place today before the seller and buyer meet for the first time. And it's a huge percentage. Then we have companies like ourselves that work internationally. We have different kinds of markets there. There are established markets, there are emerging markets, there are high context markets like all the Southern European countries, Russia, China, India, where relationships count more than facts. We from Finland and from the Nordic countries, we come from the fact land. We believe in numbers. We believe in you when you say something. It's very hard sometimes for us Finns to do marketing and stuff with people from Southern Europe, Russia, and those other countries where relationships count more than facts. But luckily, we are able to utilize our subsidiaries and even employ people with not native Finns. So these are some of the things. And as said, there's always an initiation. There is a need that arises from somewhere. Then they make specifications for that. They search for information. Then they start to evaluate. And when they start to evaluate the candidate as suppliers, that's usually the first part when they contact the supplier. And our marketers' job is to try to catch them here. Because if we are in the game only in this place, we lose it. Because they have made, as said, most of them have made their decision. I want arc welding equipment, and I want it from Kemppi, or Lincoln, or ISA. If we are not part of these three, if they have made a decision that I want this arc welding equipment from ISA, Lincoln, or Miller, we are never in the game. So, customer focus. This is a huge thing, but a thing that very many companies are thinking about now. We first need to get somehow hold of the person and the company who is looking for something new product. We need how to get it, how to get the lead, how to get to know who they are and what they want. Then this is what everybody does well, because that's what we have been doing. We sell and we make the contract and then we start to deliver. And these processes are usually very well taken care of in every company, this close part. We are again bad here to keep the customer. It is 10 times cheaper to keep the existing customer than trying to get a new one. Why are we so lousy in trying to keep the customer? Because it's nobody's role to aftercare the customer. Yes, we do maintenance and repair and blah, 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 but we don't take good care of the customer as such.
Why the customers are not so loyal anymore? That's a good question.
Well, it's one of the parties that companies, people, we don't know how to do this. And also, it's always nice to search for an alternative. But we need to make the key process so well that they don't even want to look to the alternative. And it means many, many relationships in all levels of the organization. Not only maintenance and repair, which it's usually the only touch point that is there. We need to also know, and we can use marketing automation, for instance, to work for us in that we know this company, this Andritz, that has been our customer for so and so long time, and now there's so many people from this company that are surfing on our website on this automated welding equipment. We've never sold them any automated welding equipment, but marketing automation tells us that, hey, something is cooking there. They are looking for automated welding solutions. So should our sales guy contact them? So actually, we can make data work also for us in this way, that we better know how our customers are developing their own businesses during the course. So it's in industrial marketing, it's pretty easy to keep the customer if you do it right. But if you lose them, you never get them back.
So we go back to that. Please know your customer. Who is your customer?
Exactly. So you need to know you need to know your customer, and you need to know him thoroughly. You need to know his business, and sometimes you also need to know his customer's business. In order to, like for instance, we don't sell to Shell. Shell owns all these oil rigs. We never sell to Shell. we sell to those companies who do the welding work for them. But we need to tell the welding companies that in order for you to satisfy your customer Shell, you should invest into welding management software so that you can tell your customer that every single weld holds, because I know that it was welded according to the standards needed with the materials needed. And we need to tell the audiences, we need to tell Shell, who never buys anything from us, that you should only buy welding work from companies that do have this kind of security system to show to you. So actually, it's an interesting thing to know the customer journey. And it's also interesting to know who is your customer. Because it's one of the, I think, the most interesting things that the company or the person that gives you money is not always your customer when you talk about marketing. Because you might need to do the marketing work to complete the other people than just the people who give you the money. So what we have done that we need to know the build the awareness there. They get aware of we are existing. They need to know that what they can purchase from us and how. What is our offering? And everybody needs to know who is Kemppi and what is Kemppi's offering. So when their need arises, immediately we are in the big picture with them. Then they do the research, searching, blah, 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 and on we go. And what is the thing that we need to do here? This is like focusing on mirroring back to the customer journey as such. So we really need to start to do work with them long before we even know who they are. I don't know, does any one of you know how marketing automation works? No? Okay, marketing automation works in such a way, maybe it's good for you guys to know. When you go to some website, for instance, or you get a newsletter, and every time you click something, it sends a message to this marketing automation tool, if a company is using one. If you download something from some website and you have given they ask you to give your email address so that you can download this document or something like that. That information goes to the marketing automation system. When you go to Facebook, how come the advertisements right there are exactly according to what you have just been searching for, some flights to go to Spain or something like that. Then you open up your Facebook the next day. How come I have all these advertisements here? Saying that.
By the way, this needs to become a lot more smarter than it is right now.
Yes.
Because if I, let's say that I buy a carpet, and for months and months I get bombarded with all of these ads for carpets, what is the chance that I will want to buy another carpet in the next few months?
Exactly. So it's
smart, but it's sometimes dumb.
Exactly. It's just in the consumer business.
Is it like kind of counterproductive? Because when you search one day for some product, and within next, you buy it, you forget it, and within next following days you see it on a screen.
Mm.
Doesn't it scary customer that somebody is
big
growing your own?
Well, yes and no, but I think most of us know that this is how the world has come into. But when for industrial companies and companies that are selling not consumer goods, but we are selling stuff that costs tens or even hundreds of thousands or millions, then what we can do is that finally, little by little, we can start to feed to this specific person that comes to, for instance, our website, this targeted messaging to him. So if we can see that he's always looking for something, he's downloading stuff that is related to automated welding, we can start to send automated welding related information to him, even though we don't yet know who he is, his name and so on. Finally, one day, if we can give enough food for thought for him, enough information that satisfies his need, he does download something, he asks for a demo, or he asks, could somebody contact us? And then we can move his information as a lead to our customer relation management system. And then we know already that what kind of information he has been receiving through our websites and so on. So it's an easier task for the salesman to go and meet him. And the situation on the first light doesn't happen anymore. Because then our sales guy knows what the person knows already, what kind of information he has been given, what has been his interest, and so on and so on. So it's amazing what these things can do if you use them correctly. And targeted marketing, as I said, and then which means an intelligent web presence from the company.
Aren't you afraid that if you keep the same customers, then you like kind of lose the sense of getting better or competing?
No, not really. Because of course, keeping the same customers don't grow your business. We constantly need also new customers, and we need also new products. And knowing from the existing customers that how their businesses are changing, we can also start creating and offering something new for them. So, and that is why we need to have the data flows also working towards that direction, that the existing customers are valuable for us to do more development and also to serve them better. And of course, then get new customers also. So no, we're not afraid. What Keppi has done and what we have been given good credit for is that we are like the first Finnish industrial company that has combined technical development process, the product development process, with the commercialization process. So we don't have two different processes, we have one. And we are running this through like a huge pipeline, and everything starts there. You always need to have a customer meet before we can create a project. We need to do the market research. We need to know the customer needs and so on. So usually and typically, development process starts here, and nobody cares about this. But this is how we work nowadays. We spend a lot of time here in really knowing the different needs in different kinds of markets. That's why, for instance, we have developed a completely different fleet of welding equipment to Indian, Malaysian, and Chinese market. And they are not even sold here. Because we knew, we made huge studies, and we know that those people have very, very different kinds of needs that we do here or in some other places. So we go through this whole process and the marketing and communication planning with launch plans and everything, they are here very early already. And then when we constantly do these things, for instance, knowing that, okay, this product is first launched to Russia, Germany and Italy because of these and these reasons, the development process can also take that into account. So that the first interface that we do to this digital equipment is not in Finnish, it's not in English, but in this case, it is in for instance, in Russian, German, and Italian, and whatever. And then finally, when we get to the launch preparation part, the product to be launched is already well tested, well piloted, well documented, and all the references and testimonials from piloting customers are in our hands, and we've been going through loops of research so that when the actually selling starts here, and the launch events are usually just before selling starts, so we have this gate model here. So we are pretty sure that we have correct kinds of messages, correct kind of machines, we have selected correct audiences, correct countries, correct activities. It's not always an exhibition. It's not always a news that it's not always a roadshow done by us. But for a successful launch, we need launch communication, which is something that there is a couple universities in Finland that are very good in studying launch communication and how launch actually takes place. The first communication of a launch event starts already here. There are certain audiences that we start to do the launch communication for. And finally, and it continues for a long time. I happen to know there's a thesis written of launch communication of industrial products. Unfortunately, it's in Finnish, but it's really good information to know that actually launch also, it's not a thing that happens now. The successful launch, even with a UPM company, I'm really sure, the whole communication around the launch event has started weeks, months before the actual exhibition or whatever they have takes place. Because also the launch material production usually takes a long time. You saw a part of that film with the welding management software. We launched it in 2 years ago in Britain at Williams F1 Cross or whatever you want to call it, their place there. We made 4 different kinds of movies with the Williams car in it and with they using data, so you can find all those videos on the internet. We made a huge video, like the communication started long before. We made teasers. We were telling but not giving. And we were raising the interest by doing completely, and we were not talking about the product at all. We were in internet, in social media, in many places, we were talking about things that this solution that we are coming out with is a perfect match to. And by the time that we actually launched, there was already so and so many people who really wanted it, without knowing what was its name, but we were creating a solution to their needs that we had detected years back. And when we started launching, as we are doing now, we are bringing out next October the world's latest technology, internet-connected welding equipment. And we have started launch communication already, and launch event is in October. But we don't talk about the equipment at all. We talk about the things that it can, how it can bring value to you. We are talking about the issues that might be in your mind. You are thinking about what I should get a solution for. So we are doing all that. We are giving bits and pieces even on how this equipment was made. 15-second videos and so on, showing something but not telling anything. So just raising the interest. So launch starts a long time before the actual event and actual outcome with the product name and everything is there. Customer journey and touch points. Those are two things that you need to know. Know your customer, know their journey. But you also need to know what are the touch points, where they can meet you, one way or another. This is just a generic list, and it's for different products and for different companies, it's different. But there's what are the touch points where they can meet you in the initiation awareness stage, where we don't know you and you don't know us. Social media, websites, e-nurturing comes from marketing automation activities and so on. So then you can see that there are different touch points. And we need to make sure that the messages that that they get from us and the product, they don't tell a different language, no matter in which touch point they are. When we were starting to at Kempi creating the touch point sheen here, it was a joke, but our managing director said, well, isn't the first touch point and the only touch point to Kempi when the customer calls our switchboard? No, it's not. as you can see, it's the person, phone, email, face face-to-face events, they're pretty far away in the customer journey that you get to meet them. Then there are things that are present all the time. References. Did we do a good job before? What do the companies that we have delivered something to tell to their friend companies? Did we do it lousy or not? So actually, when you talk about brand and reputation, it's this one that counts the most. Nothing else. If we did a lousy job, that's bad reference. And unluckily, bad bell rings louder than the good bell. Okay, branding in marketing, branding in launching, tell stories. Tell stories in the form of video. In many times I've had young audience like this one, I ask, do you read books or do you watch movies?
Both.
Yeah. You are not a typical one. Which is good that you do both, but many say, I more watch movies than read books. And I do rather, when I get information on a product that I probably would like to buy, I'd rather watch movies from their website than read brochures. Yeah. So tell stories and tell them in the form of video. And do all that for search engines. So if you are not found when somebody Googles a new sweatshirt or something like that, and your offering is not among the top three, you're not there. And that's how it goes. You never go to the second page in Google searches. You take a look at the first five, maybe, and that's it. So you need to work in all your marketing towards the fact that you are found in Google, Baidu, whatever other search engines the way that you have to. Since having a young audience, I brought the social media specials here. It's so full of different channels that you really need to again know the cultural differences by countries, the personal differences by countries. Do you people use the same channels and platforms for work and pleasure? And that has been studied a lot. And that is something that has made all marketing really, really hard nowadays, because actually we do work the same way. No matter are we looking for a new nail polish, or are we looking for a new car, or am I looking at my work information for the new slate or something like that, the machine. We tend to look for information in the same way. And that is why, and using even the same devices. In certain countries they use tablets, in certain countries they use desktops, certain countries people use laptops and they use smartphones or they use handbags. So actually we need to know when we make marketing campaigns that to which kind of audience is using which kinds of devices are we making these campaigns for. Okay, there are certain channels that are more popular among industrial users. LinkedIn, Twitter, Instagram is raising a lot. Facebook is for certain people, but not that much, and so on. So you really need to think about, and the Chinese channels and the Russian channels that we have been dealing with, they're very different, and so on. But for any company, you need to think, why am I in social media? Do I have the person in my company to take care of that social media channel that we are doing? If you don't go. If you create a website, if you create a Twitter account for the company that you work for, but there is nobody to take care of that, then it's negative for you. So if you go to social media, company-wise. Please remember that you need to have a person to take care of that. This is what we do. We talk about the web big picture. We have the website there, which I always call a road. And then we have all these different social media channels and portals and digital forums that we want to be present somehow. And I say that all the roads lead to Rome, as the old saying goes. And the Kempi.com is just a place for the factual information. But ours, as our competitors also, their soul, the feeling that you get out of those companies, it's in the social media. And the websites, the company websites, are just facts. And it's going more and more towards that way. So just having a really cute, good website, but you don't have the roads to lead to the website, you are not able to collect that much information as you want it to, and the leads that you want it to. Looks like it's time for probably the last movie.
Kempi is a company dedicated to welding excellence. In our view, excellence is about people. It starts with the individual. It starts with welders who realize even the most peculiar plans into amazing constructions around us. It lies in welding production managers who know every detail of their productions. Excellence is found throughout the whole chain, from a welder to an owner to a final user. Kempi is the Arc Welding Knowledge Company. Only knowledge enables us all to achieve our goals. Only by challenging the conventional you achieve something bigger. We at Kempi will keep on researching and discovering. We never stop developing our solutions further in order to reinvent quality and productivity over and over again. Our experts are keen to share their knowledge with the whole welding industry to achieve excellence. Curiosity, a strong desire to know, has driven the Kempi family for over 65 years. Our open-minded attitude and continuous search for new ideas has manifested in technological innovations. Kempi has been setting new industry standards ever since we invented the inverter technology decades ago. The same desire drives people at Kempi today, when we lead the revolution of digitalization in welding. Our innovation pipeline has numerous ideas constantly under development. A true innovation changes the way we see and do things. We put user experience at the center of all product development. In the age of the Internet of Things, everything that can be connected will be connected. Now, you can have a full 360-degree view on your welding production. We won't compromise at any stage of Kempi experience. Our own manufacturing ensures that you get the original Kempi each time. Kempi respects individual values. Our welding solutions are designed to support people in their own work. With Kempi, you are more productive in what you do. If you want a proven technology or an affordable welding startup, we will find a solution together. In industrial welding, you achieve the highest return on investment by advanced operational automation and total welding management. Welding excellence is about people, and so is business. It's more than just knowing, it's sharing. Together, we always find new value to share. No matter how you are connected to the world of welding, or wherever you are, we invite you to join the Welding Excellence. We invite you to participate. We invite you to share. We invite you to know. Kempi. And you know.
Okay, thank you Päivi very much for your presentation. We had a lot of about marketing and everything, and actually had questions about the how important people are behind the story, but I got the answer.
Okay, it's all about people.
Yeah, that's right. And
there's
a, of course a little bit differences between the UPM and Kempi, because Kempi is a family-owned company and the UPM is a public, so there's some differences between the message, of course.
Yeah.
when you look the video, maybe you've got the idea about the company. There's a lot of pictures about the people behind the company's business and so on. So now we have some time for the discussion and questions. So please, if you have any questions, to Päivi. Before the lunch.
Hunger. Yeah.
Are you still sponsoring Valtteri Bottas?
A very good question. We are not sponsoring F1. We are not sponsoring Williams. We have a personal agreement with Valtteri Bottas. It's a personal agreement with him, and the reason behind that is that Kempty was the first company to start sponsoring Valtteri Bottas when he was a little boy. He's from this city, as you guys know.
So, do you know who is Valtteri?
Valtteri Bottas, F1
driver. Formula 1 driver.
Yes. He's from this city, and Kempty was the first company who started to invest and sponsor him. And now that we used to have a sponsorship agreement with Williams, but we don't anymore. But Valtteri wanted to continue as personal ambassador for Kempty because of all the good work that we have been going through.
But you still have your name somewhere in the helmet, though.
Yes, we do have the name in the helmet. But it's not in the car; it's in the helmet because it's a personal
thing. Yeah.
Okay, more questions.
Maybe you know it all now. So know your customer and do accordingly.
In which way you are better than your competitors?
Good question.
Technologically saying, there's no difference. We have a better presence throughout the world. We, each one of us, main competitors, we have focused on certain era or certain scheme within the manual welding thing. We are, we have competitors that are public companies. We are more personal because we are closer to the audiences. We have been the pioneers, as you saw in the first video. We were the first company in the world to create inverters. That was back in the 80s. 100% of today's welding equipment, no matter who makes them, where they are sold, use inverter technology. So we are seen as the pioneers. We are followed. We are wanted because we are seen as a very innovative company. We brought the first ever digital welding equipment to the world. We were the first company to bring the welding management software. So it's some people just want to trust the fact that Kempty brand means latest development, latest quality. You there had a question.
I'm just thinking about used to be a practice that a company tried to do some marketing, doing some social activities or some humanitarian work or some support let's say for poor people, sick people, development countries and so on. Do you think that this marketing tool is also used in recent days, and do you deal with that also?
Yes and yes. So these kinds of mechanisms are used still today, but more and more they need to be somehow connected to the business that you are doing or the area where you are at. Like we are the founders of the Vesijärvi Foundation. The lake that we are on used to be in very, very poor shape I think 20 decades ago or something like that. Kempty created a foundation to save Lake Vesijärvi, for instance. And then we do have some other, we have one school project in somewhere Far East Asia because of some reason. But yes, we do. But companies don't use them that much anymore if
the thing is not really related somehow to your business. In my previous life, I used to work for a long time for a company that makes a precast concrete factories throughout the world. And we had this Red Cross campaign 3 years back, where we collected money to, I don't know what you call them, it's like a toilet kind of thing for a certain area in Africa. And it's called the world's smallest precast concrete element. Because what they did was that, you know, they have the sanitary problem in those countries, as you all know. So what they did, it was also dangerous for ladies, for instance, to go to do their stuff, because, you know, it's rapes and stuff were around all the time. So they created a system to make these really small square concrete plates, and they had footprints there. And people know that I go there and go down, and that's the toilet I need to work for. And we got a really, really good response for that. And we also used that as part of our really big exhibition event. So we collected money for 104,000 little small toilets to be brought to that place. So that was exactly in connection with the precast concrete that we were working with. And then it pays off. And then it also interests the audiences when you can find such a charity place that is related to your business.
One question. You said very firmly that technologically there's no real difference between your process or your solutions to the other companies. Would you do the same? Would you communicate the same if you were potential buyers of your products? So is this kind of like a strategy in your company to say that that we're not focusing on technology, we're focusing on solutions or on digitalization?
Yeah, I wouldn't say to a potential buyer that, okay, we say the same as you, yes, everybody else does. But as a technology-wise, we know that the technology and everybody in the field knows that the technologies don't give that much of an edge. So they are really minor things, and we are the specialists in utilizing different kinds of apps and software to make the arc burn better and to collect the information and use modern ways of doing the actual welding equipment work, or the welding work.
So be easier, better welding easier. Experience.
Yeah, so it's welding experience. And it comes from many other things and not just the nuts and bolts.
So you're not doing or supporting any research to improve technology?
Yes, we do. Actually, Kempi uses 10% of its revenue to research and development, which is a huge amount of money, and especially when we are not a big company. Out of the 220 people that work here in Lahti, in our office, 100 are employed by the research, development and innovation. Yes, we do, of course, everybody has. If you don't do the hardware development, you lose the game. So it needs to be heavily going on all the time. But the others are doing the same. So, of course, everybody is doing the technology development heavily all the time. But we are trying to add to the pure nuts and bolts something else. Through the intelligence, through the connectivity, through the software, through the different kinds of cute little apps that you can download and put into your equipment and so on.
So the research is not really to gain like an advantage or an edge, it's more to keep up with everyone else.
No, it's really to get the advantage or the edge, but it's not in the hardware only.
I see.
So it's in the whole big picture. So it's, yes, it's more about getting the full solution and getting the added value and knowing what the customer needs and then creating and researching, developing the solution to that need. And it's not always in the hardware.
I know that you have cooperated with our university's faculty of design. Mm-hmm. So how big topic is this design for Kempi today?
Okay, Genk again. It's one of the first companies in the field that did start to use industrial design. And Kemppi has won numerous prizes, international prizes on industrial development. We do have an industrial, you also saw it on the film, we have an industrial design department, internal industrial designers that have graduated from the Design Institute here and also from the University of Arts and so on. So we have our own industrial designers in-house. It's very important for the equipment to also look good, feel good in your hand, and industrial design is something that makes the welders happier. We used to have the slogan, and we still do, the joy of welding. By importing in the industrial design into the everyday tools that they use, it makes welding more enjoyable and easier. So it's a very, very highly taken in our company to use industrial design.
Okay. Need more? Okay.
Have you heard something about wood welding?
And wood welding?
Yeah.
I have.
Me too. Do you? And if the, do you do some research related to that subject?
No, we are in metals.
In metals only. Okay. So you don't do any plastic welding or anything?
No.
Something
we are in
else.
Metals.
Only metals.
It's a choice.
Okay.
Being our size of a company and being an expert in metal arc welding, so that's our focus.
I see.
One more question. As you all can see, I can recognize certain color today.
Yeah,
so
color.
How important is color
your marketing
very,
story?
Very important. We also have a very strict brand policy, and we have a brand strategy, and color, of course, color is very important, and that's one of the differentiating things also within the industry, that how you use the colors. So
what
we have black, white,
of the color?
I wouldn't know. Well, have you ever seen the welding arc burning?
All right. Okay. That's the reason.
Yes.
Okay. Okay. Let's have one more comment.